9 coaches, and we've got 902. We're doing well on time. It's going to be great to hear what you guys have to say. So I've got some questions that I've asked them already, just to kind of focus our time. And so we're going to get right into it. But before I do that, let me pray, and we're going to invite the Lord to just kind of bless the things that He has taught you guys, and that we'd have open hearts, and we'd be able to hear from Him. So let's pray. Lord, thank you for how you use other people in our life. It would be really bad if on this journey of life it was just us, because there's things that you teach us, people who've gone ahead, people who have made right choices, people who've made mistakes. We learn from all sorts of angles on the road. Thank you for that, Lord. And I pray that we would have ears to hear what you have to say through the wisdom that will be shared in some of the Bible that would even be shared, the Bible wisdom, through their lives that's here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All righty. Get my list of questions here. Before we do that, I know you've got most of the names. Let's do this. I'll pass the microphone down. Introduce yourself, who you are, your sport, and then introduce or share how you've been involved with AIA in what capacity, whether you were a student here or what you're doing now.
Cool.
So far. Okay?
Hi everyone, my name is Kristen Kelsey. I'm our assistant volleyball coach, and I actually played volleyball here from 2010 to 2014. I was involved in Athletes in Action through small Bible studies, and also had the privilege of going on the South Africa trip my junior year, which was pretty incredible and life-changing for me. So.
Hey guys, I'm Becky Stiles. I am the assistant field hockey coach here at Michigan State, and I also played here from 2011 to 2015, and I was involved just the same. I actually went to South Africa, and then I also coached at Indiana, was able to be involved with their Athletes in Action there, which was just really cool to see this ministry just in another school. So yeah, now I'm back in the green and white, which is awesome.
Woo! I'm Dan Cole. I'm the hockey coach here. I also played at Michigan State way back in the 80s, so it was a good decade. If anybody other than Phil remembers it, but got involved. I've been back here a year, but it was kind of interesting because just before I came back here, I was with the U.S. program, and a lot of the guys from both birth years that we were coaching were involved. And I talked to the Mark, who's kind of in charge of those guys there, and kind of filled me in. And then I was down in Florida at the NCAA meetings and talked to a guy that was involved with it. And then I got here, and Phil came barging in my office one of my first days, so it was kind of something it was meant to be to get involved. And Joe and Coach Boss and myself, we meet on Wednesday mornings, and now spreading out to deal with the students, which is great. Appreciate Phil and all the work he does.
My name is Kayla Jackson. They call me Coach KJ. I work with softball here. I did not go to Michigan State. Sorry to let everybody down. I had a room in the chain. You should have sat here. Sorry. But I got involved in AIA with Leah Forrester when she came to my office and told me that I should come. And how do you turn her down? She's very bold. So I came, and since then I ended up taking a great opportunity and went to UTC in SoCal, which is awesome. You guys should all sign up. I highly recommend it. So that was life-changing for me. And ever since then, we came back and started a women's Bible study for our assistant coaches. And that's been pretty awesome as well.
I'm Caroline. I'm the assistant golf coach here. I played, graduated in 2013, and got involved with Athletes in Action right when I got on campus. Went to a couple winter retreats and went to Ultimate Training Camp, which really kind of set me up for the rest of college and made it all much better with the community in here, everything. And now being with the fellow assistant coaches in our Bible study and others in our age range has been really good to just keep us in community and really building off each other, because once you graduate, you don't always have that. And so for us to have that with each other still is pretty awesome.
Good evening. I'm Brad Salem. I'm assistant football coach here, going into my ninth season. Did not go to school here, but I did get my master's here. I didn't play here. But I came as a graduate assistant 23 years ago. And I will say this spiritual climate was not that. And so when I got here with Coach D'Antonio in 2010, this is awesome to see, this many people here, and you at least here and kind of sharing your lives with each other. We're kind of doing the same thing as coaches, and Phil really is very influential to us and in kind of our staff Bible studies as you look to lean on people throughout your life.
Hello, I'm Jake Boss. I'm the baseball coach here. This is my 10th year at Michigan State. I, too, did not go to Michigan State, but much like Coach Cole, Phil barged into my press conference the day that I got hired, and that was the first time I had met him, and we've had a great relationship ever since. Been to South Africa four times with South Africa, and we meet, like Coach Cole said, every Wednesday morning, and yeah, it's been awesome. So.
Joe Exter. Like Jake, I did not go to Michigan State, and I ended up in this meeting tonight the same way that I ended up at Michigan State. Coach Cole invited me, and when he got the job, he called me. I was blessed to be able to come over here and share with him an opportunity at a great university. And I've actually been a lot more places than I look, because I'm slightly older than I look, and I understand that. And the best part about Michigan State is the people. So remember that wherever you're walking around today. And same thing, the way I ended up here is how I ended up meeting with Coach and Jake on Wednesday mornings. True blessing.
You didn't knock on your door?
No.
Hi, I'm Kathy George. I'm the volleyball coach here, and I've been here for 13 years now, so I'm getting to be one of the elders, I think. But I was a speaker, actually, for Athletes in Action probably about 10 years ago, and have very happy to see a lot of our volleyball players here today and sharing in the gospel and learning more about Christ. So I'm very blessed to be here, so thank you very much, and we'll get started, I guess.
Big shout out to Coach Boss, win number 300 on Sunday. 300! Sorry, that's the fast version of our little Spartan thing. And Becky, I was with her when her iPhone was stolen in Paris on the subway, so another fun fact tonight. I'm just going to throw in the fun facts here. Okay, so the first question I want to ask you guys is this, and Joe and Kathy, I'd love for you guys to speak to this. And Joe, since we saw part of that ESPN video on you, maybe we'll start with you. Question is, what are some of the struggles you faced as an athlete? And then how did you handle them?
Well, I don't even know if I need that. Can you guys hear me? Girls hear me? You want me to have this?
Yeah.
All right, well, obviously, you guys, we started this off with struggles or trials that we found and faced as an athlete, and I think I would have to share my story. And you saw part of it, because in 2003, you saw what happened. Had some pretty horrific injuries, whether it was being in a coma with two skull fractures. I actually had my vocal cords were paralyzed as well. And that situation right there was a life-shaping moment. That was in 2003. And when you're traveling through in life, you think, okay, you're gonna have these major things that you face, you get through them, then you move on, and life is sunshine after that. Well, 5 years later, in 2008, that same exact accident, while coaching, happened again. I had 5 skull fractures. It was in intensive care. Those are 2 life-shaping moments. And you gotta learn from things that you go through, and you have to also lean on things. And we can sit here and say, well, what did I learn? The first one, in 2003, I learned the power of prayer and how powerful it can be. Because obviously, my small community at Merrimack College was praying for me. The strong hockey community was praying for me, and all my family and friends, et cetera, were praying for me, and people I never met were praying for me. And that's what carried me through. It wasn't you wake up from a coma and you're ready. There's a little bit of a struggle you go through after that, and I was able to make it through that. I'll share that story in a moment. Then in 2008, oof, it happens again. So just when you're traveling along through life, there's gonna be a tough part of it, and that's a big part of life in itself. And you gotta learn, well, what did I learn from that? Number one, and you'll see when I go to practice, always wear a helmet. You gotta be safe. Right? Shame on me on that. Mopeds, whatever it is. As we learn around campus. And I don't want to get too long-winded, so I'm trying to keep this as short and brief as possible. But the other thing that I learned from that is how much God loves us and how much God loves me. Because there's always going to be times in our life where we go through struggles or we make mistakes or things happen. You're like, oh, I can't believe I did that. Does God really love me? Am I judging or serving him the way he needs to be? And sure, I was questioning that at that time. But guess what? God loves me. And God loves you just as much, which is powerful. So those are the things that I learned while going through it. But then there's also got to be something that you lean on when you're going through something, whether it's big like that or something small that we all lean on every day. And I'm going to share with you what that is. When I was 14 years old, I left home, went away to a boarding school. Probably similar feelings that you guys are going through your freshman year. I was scared, I was lonely, I was afraid, all emotions I never dealt with before in my life. And I sat there, I'm like, oof, and I was struggling. How am I going to get through this? I had great people around me, but I'm still struggling on a daily basis. But I remembered one thing that my mother said to me, and clearly she plays a big role in my life. She always would say to me, Joe, trust God. Give it all to him, and he will take care of you. When I was a kid, I was like, all right, Mom, enough. When I was alone and scared by myself, I decided to dig into that. And how did I dig in? You got to find something that you can dig into. She would give me a daily bread, little reading that I use every day, and still use every day to this day right here. And I dove into that. And I realized, okay, this relates to what I'm going through here. There was a church on campus. It was not a Catholic school, but it was a little church that sat there. I went and dove into that. And that's where I started to have the habits and form the relationship with Jesus and our Lord. That's helped carry me through what I went through in 03. Because I said earlier, you just don't wake up and everything's rosy. You got to battle. You got to go through. You need to have something to lean on. And I had something to lean on. 5 years later, the same exact thing. Where did it all begin? When I was 14 years old struggling. And a lot of you guys and girls might be going through very similar things here. It's invaluable. I can't state enough how critical it is. Dive into the Word. Phil preaches this to us every Wednesday. I can't even read half the words that are in there. I'm not a great reader, I'll say that right now. But I understand the message. And I know one day I'll be able to sit in front of the Lord. He's not going to ask me to recite the Bible to him. He's going to ask me if I believe in his Son. And I can look and know it peacefully. And my mom knew this, my family member knew this, and hopefully those around me know, yes, he believes in the Lord, and he's going to be okay. So I don't want to take up too much of the time. I thank you for listening to my story here, and hopefully if you grab one thing out of it, you take it with you tonight.
All right, so my story is just a little bit different, and one of the questions that Phil kind of was talking about here was some of the struggles that you faced when you were in college, and my college time was a little bit different than probably yours. In the sense that I was a little bit of a social being in college. And I like to talk a lot, and I'm very social. I'll get out there, and needless to say, might be a little wild as well. So I started off that way, and it was the beginning of my time. And as my years went on, I got a little bit better because I started to become disciplined and understand what I needed to do in my career as a volleyball player and as a person. But I'll never forget it. As my team knows, I was a very confident player early when I played, and I really didn't face a lot of struggles as a player early. But I got to this place where I was in a tournament, and it was at Cal Poly, and we were heading to the University of Hawaii right after that tournament, and we were going to play the defending national champions, I hit this like place where I could do nothing right. I was hitting balls in the net, I was hitting them out of bounds, I was hitting them in the block, I just couldn't do anything. And for the first time really, I questioned myself and my abilities and what was gonna happen, and I was absolutely freaked out. I didn't know what to do. So I went out, and of course I was in Illinois, so I'm used to cold, but we were now in California, and I'm sitting out by the pool, and nobody wanted to come near me because they didn't know what to say to me. You know, absolutely nobody knew what to say. But Tracy Stroyan, one of my teammates, came out. Now, Tracy was this girl that in the bus, she would always be over there reading her Bible, and she would be, you know, she would just kind of be off on her own a little bit. And because I was so social and a little bit wild, I really didn't identify with that right away. So I didn't know, but I always respected Tracy, and she was a great player. So Tracy comes out to me, and she sits on the chair next to me, and she starts reading Bible verses to me. And I was so touched, and I was so moved at that time, that I knew something special happened. And I was so fearful that I was not gonna get my game back. And I was so worried, but I started to believe and trust in what she was saying. And we went on to Hawaii, and we went and we beat that team. And I felt very confident, and I felt very, you know, right now I built this relationship now with Tracy, this person that probably I wouldn't have. And I will tell you to this day, that's the seed that was planted in me that changed my life forever. And that seed didn't grow for a while. It didn't take root until a little bit later on, but it did, and it really has made an impact. To the point that every time she lives out in near Champaign-Urbana, that she always comes to our matches when we play University of Illinois. And so I took her out, I introduced her to the team, and I told them all the story of what happened with Tracy Stroyan. But she was a great impact to me, and I think that what you need to remember is when you're out there and you're with people, you might not think that they're always listening, but they are. And you don't know who you're impacting, but you are. And that can be something that will be enriching people's lives forever, so I just want you to remember that. And that's something big to me.
Webster's, under coach, I think it's the third line down, it'll say extremely busy person as a definition, right? Synonymous with busy. Coaches are always busy. So this next question has to do with that. Jake and KJ, what do you practically do now to stay grounded in your faith, especially with your crazy busy lifestyle?
Well, it's crazy busy. Not only at work, but I've got a wife and three kids at home, and they're crazy busy, just like everyone was when they were in high school and all that. And so, for me to stay grounded, I have to make time to get into the Word every day. And sometimes that doesn't happen at home, because I'm not the best morning guy, and my kids aren't good morning people either, and it's mayhem in our house. From about 6 o'clock in the morning to 7:15, and that's the time we're trying to get everybody ready and get everybody out the door. And so for me, I tried to have a quiet time at home. It wasn't working, and so I started doing it in the office. And it's the first thing that I do when I get into the office in the morning. And I'll take my youngest daughter to school, drop her off, and I'm in the office by 7:45 maybe in the morning, and I'll walk into my office and shut the door and just kind of start the day that way before I turn the computer on, before I, do anything. My Bible sits right there, it's in my bag, I just got started with a reading plan also, which for me helps me a lot, keeps me organized. And so I'll hit that for maybe 5 or 10 minutes and then spend some time in prayer. But the other thing is for me to stay grounded, I pray a lot. And it's not, it's not get down on your hands and knees and fold your hands and close your eyes and pray. I'm in the car and I pray. My most favorite part of game day is the national anthem, because that is a chance for me to take a step back and be still and pray. And, I've been doing this here for 10 years. I don't think I've heard one national anthem the entire time, because, that's my time to pray before the game starts. I pray before practice, walking out there, God give me wisdom to lead these guys. And so I almost feel like it's a constant state of prayer, for a lot of different reasons. I'm not the smartest guy, kind of like Joe, so I feel like I need as much help as I can get. But it does help keep me grounded. It helps keep perspective, I think my family is the third thing that probably keeps me grounded. I've got, like I said, three kids. Our youngest is 9 years old, and whether we win or lose, that little girl comes running to the door every time I get home, and there's nothing like it, and I get to, sit down. My daughter will be a freshman in college next year. She's going to go to Wheaton College, and talking with her about, her plans and her dreams, and my son plays, baseball, football, and is a sophomore right now, so, my family definitely, helps keep me grounded. But like Joe said, grab onto something, grab onto the Word, every day, and pray. Well, pray without ceasing, right?
And my guess is, Jake, when you do that, there's a lot of days when it's probably just, okay, I'm doing it. But when the time comes when the wind really blows, you're really glad that you anchored yourself in there and prepared, practiced.
No doubt.
There's two things. One is I need friends. I need that in my life. And when I say friends, I don't mean just people I like to hang out with. Like these guys, if I didn't have them, I don't know what my life would look like. Those kind of friends, because they invest in my soul. They care more about my relationship with Christ than my relationship with them. So just having that friendship, somebody to hold on to, somebody to be accountable to, and go through something with, to truly fellowship, to go through something with somebody, is huge. So friendship for me, getting involved with people who are investing in my soul. But the big one, I think, that I use whenever I saw the question of practically grounded in my faith, I think of UTC. And when I was out at UTC, they had this, they gave us some tools. And they said they wanted us to have a physical reminder to remind us of our truth. Okay, so my truth was I am a child of God. All right, and my physical reminder, I have a scar on my wrist. And I'm sure my players will notice now, but I often grab my wrists. I often grab my wrists in practice. Okay, I've had the scar since I was a kid, so it's not going anywhere. Might as well use that as my physical reminder. So I am touching my scar constantly because I need to remind myself that I'm a child of God. Okay, and I'll give you an example of what this looks like on the daily because this is my life. Okay, as being a coach. All right, I'm a softball coach. All right, I coach at Michigan State University, and I have one job. My job is to coach hitters. I have to get them to swing better. So they hit better, so we score runs, so we win ball games. That is my job. And if we don't, I am a failure. I have let everyone down. I had one job. That's all I had to do. And now I've let my players down. They have serious trust issues with me now. They can't stand to look at me because I let them down the wrong path. I don't know how to please my boss. I don't know how to please my coworkers. And I have no purpose why I'm here freezing my butt off in Michigan. And this is, now by the way, nobody ever said these things to me. These are just things that go on up here in Crazy Town when I don't have anything anchored to myself, like that I don't have any anchor, okay? So when I was like, wow, when I learned I could have a physical reminder to look at something to bring me back, that helped a ton. So what I do is I look at it and I hold it and I remember I'm a child of God and I say it a couple times. I'm like, I'm a child of God. First time it comes out, it's like, I'm a child of God. Shit. And then the second time, it's like, I'm a child of God. And then by the third time, it's like, I am a child of God. I am daughter to the creator of the universe. I am a princess in the kingdom of heaven. I am adored. I am loved. I am the bride. I am amazing. I am awesome. I mean, if you don't believe it, look in the Bible. It may not say that you're amazing and I'm awesome, but it's implied, okay? So that's how I feel. And I learned this, and that is true. And now, when I started operating out of a place of what is true, I am a beloved child of God. He loves me. I am adored. Now I go forth, and I get to coach softball today. And you know who I get to work with? I get to work with my players, who I get to share my faith with. I have coaches asking me questions about my faith, and I get to talk about it. And it's exciting because my purpose here, while I'm freezing my butt off in Michigan, is to glorify God. And I get to do that every single day. So when you read Psalm 63 and it says his steadfast love is better than life, think about that. His steadfast love, all those things I just described about being the queen of God, you know what I mean? Like I am child of God, right? Isn't that so much better than being a softball coach, which is my life? So if you look at it, I hold myself to that because I look at my wrist and I'm constantly reminded I am a child of God. I get to empower young women every day. This is incredible. I get to glorify God by just simply being myself. All of a sudden, I have courage. I have compassion that wasn't there before when I was so worried if I was pleasing everybody. I have an insane confidence because the battle's already won. What can I fail at? So I play and I coach with so much more freedom than I would have originally. So holding myself down to an anchor of a physical reminder is something that helps me stay grounded every single day.
Awesome. There is a groundbreaking new book on hitting about how to hit 400.
Yeah, apparently.
Three doors down there, you can go visit and get a signed copy of it.
Homework.
Or something about 400. Like that. Yeah. No, seriously, KJ, though, that's awesome because don't we confuse what we do who we are. And it's like, no, I make my money by coaching, but that's not who I am, right? You're a child of God. That's awesome. Thank you for that. Next question, Kristen and Brad.
It's kind of one of those questions of, what do I wish I would have known then when I was in college that I know now? And specifically, like, you know, how have I really grown spiritually? Because that first one is a little bit of a wide open question. But yeah, specifically spiritually, what's the change?
So we were told these questions before we came, and I started reflecting on that and what my growth is. It's someone who sat in your seats, right? My butt was in your seat all of 4 or 5 years ago to now being an assistant coach and, like KJ said, having the privilege of mentoring young women every day. And I think for me, I think when I was in your seat, I had a lot of identities, right? I was captain of the volleyball team, I was a setter, I was a friend, I was a girlfriend, I was SAC president, I was a great student, and I kind of fed off all of these, not lies, because they were truths, but these other things that were giving me personal satisfaction, right? So I could check the box that 4.0 kid, honors college kid, captain, like, oh, that kid's got everything going for her, right? I came to AIA, I went to South Africa, like, it was just this perfect little storm. You could tie it in a ribbon, and I felt like my identity in Christ was just another thing that I compounded, right? I'm a Christian, I'm in a Bible study, check, check, check. I grew up being very much in the thought that I was earning my salvation, right? And that was something that I had to check those boxes. So my life revolved around a lot around that. Am I checking the criteria that either I'm setting for myself with my personal standard or that others are perceiving of me? And that was something that I held probably more than I spoke about, was how I was viewed by others. So then here comes my first year of coaching, right? I get hired, I graduate in May 2014, I'm hired 6, 7, 8 months later in January. And now all my friends, who I still have here, are student athletes or are living a much different life than I am with my peers up here, much different. And it was probably one of the loneliest years of my life, my first year coaching, because now my friends and I have not as much in common, right? I'm in this job where I'm traveling every weekend, I'm busier, and I don't mean this in condescending, but busier than, as a student athlete, I thought I was pretty busy, and now I'm just, my head's trying to stay afloat. And I really had to recenter of who am I and what's my identity. I'm no longer in school, I'm no longer president of staff, I'm no longer a captain, I'm no longer all these other things that I kind of rested my hat on. And now I'm a coach, and I have one job, as KJ said, and I love it, and I'm privileged to be in that role, but now, who am I, right? And I think that was the turning point for me to say, okay, now my identity in Christ was something I used to use to speak about and to have those conversations, but did I really live that, and did I really believe that with my whole heart? And I think for me, it has become now, that is my number one. Like KJ said, when I have those trials in my life, that's what I go back to. I don't lean on all those other things that maybe I thought were as important as they were. But I wish I would have had that confidence and that realization as a student athlete, because I think I had that satisfaction a lot of other things, where at the end of the day, that's the only thing that's important, is my salvation and the gospel in Christ. And I probably spoke those things but didn't truly believe them or live them. And I think that's the biggest thing. If I could go back, I wish I could learn that lesson earlier. Because now it's the greatest honor of my life, and then it was kind of a side hobby, or it was in my bio, right? And so I think that's the biggest thing that I've grown in my faith, is that now that is the number one thing. And through that year of trial has brought me on the other side of that, and that needed to happen. But I wish, kind of going back, I would have really fully jumped in with 2 feet earlier with that.
Awesome, Kristen. As been said, is the Lord resident or is he president in your life? So you articulated that well. So, right.
Well, I think there's so many things we could all share with really any of these questions. And, you know, we've sat in this seat maybe at some point in our life. I was very fortunate as far as spiritually going up through college, being in very good Christian groups and Bible studies, and I think people were very influential in my life. And I think the thing I was trying to think of, just as I, you know, what is it that I look back on? I think try to live in the moment and realize, like, what you're building. I mean, literally just building a house. You're building blocks through these years at Michigan State, and what you're building is going to create who you are and who you become through God's eyes and in your life. And so all the different trials that you go through, you know, I just go back to literally my experiences in college and the verses and the Bible studies and the people. And so the other thing, just building off an organization like this or an opportunity like this just to meet on Tuesday nights, I think you really need to pour into people, but you need people to pour into you. And sometimes maybe I didn't get that in college until I left. And then I think when you do leave, you're going to find that my college roommate was sort of funny. He said things in weird ways. He always says, now he says, well, I don't need any more friends, which seems like a real negative statement. But he's talking very sincerely about he wants people in his life that care about him. And I think that's what you learn now at this age are the relationships you have you'll keep forever. But when you leave here, try to find someone like the person sitting next to you. Because there'll be struggles that you go through, you know, whether it be through family or marriage or job and all the things that the world requires you to be successful, but just that you can lean on God, you know, through the troubled times. And so you're truly building an awesome foundation really just by being here tonight. To me, this is encouraging, you know, looking at this and that you're here. And then eventually, sometimes you're sitting there by yourself, and all of us were at one point in our lives, and you're choosing to seek God really basically because you chose to seek God in college. Or at some point in your life, you leaned on when you're 14, you know, and there's things like that. So just encourage you to just stay faithful, stay grounded, and just keep seeking His face.
Thanks, and you bring up a great point, just the critical time of life, right? Some of the habits and the things that you start now, you'll take with you the rest of your life. So, Dan, Becky, question for you guys. We started to hit on this topic of identity a little bit. We talk about not finding our identity in our sport as an athlete, you know, here at AIA, but as a coach, how do you handle not finding your identity as a coach or not finding it in your program or the wins and losses or your reputation? So, how do you deal with that?
So for me, I actually kind of did, after I graduated from Michigan State, I did a little stint as a financial bank examiner, which if you ask Julie or anyone else here that knows me, that just wasn't who I was. And so I got into coaching, and I love people, I love working with people, and so I really felt like I was trying to find my identity in what I was doing, whether it was working at the bank or now working in coaching. And what I've been finding is a lot of times being new in coaching, I tend to compare myself. I tend to say, what's so and so doing? You know, they do a lot better job than I do. How come I'm like this? And I put it all back on myself. And I even think back as my time as a student athlete, and it's so easy when we set a high standard for ourselves and we put a lot of pressure on ourselves to perform and to be awesome and to do what our coaches say. It's exhausting. And I found myself as a coach too, exhausted at trying to reach that. Like, yes, we can try and perform well, and God wants us to perform at our best, but when it's what defines us, it's exhausting. And I found myself doing that even as a coach. But the encouraging thing is that the Lord doesn't see us that way. He doesn't define us by our job or by our coaching or how we play on the field or how we hit the ball or how we run around the track. We're not defined by that. And it's been really cool to see how God's just working in my heart and when I was an athlete and now as a coach too, and just how we are so defined by who God says we are. And there's nothing that can take that from you. And I'll never forget when I was a senior, I had the opportunity to come up and speak at the last AIA meeting. And I remember talking about how having a vertical perspective on life. And so for me, that's just huge because a lot of times I have that horizontal perspective where I'm looking to, you know, what's Kristen doing? What do they think of me? What does she think of me? But when I live with that vertical perspective of, Lord, have your way in my life, and when I'm talking to the Lord, like we're talking about prayer and digging into the scriptures, when I am focused on what the Lord thinks of me, that's a life worth living. So.
Yeah, it's hard, and you guys, as
as student athletes got a lot going on, and it is how you end up defining yourself. And you know, I'm 4 years here playing, and then I played pro for 11 years, and then this is my 19th year of coaching. So really, hockey's been, you know, everything I've done. I mean, that's everything that I paid for my family has come through hockey, and that's kind of how I define myself. And you can't really get away from being an athlete, because yeah, that's part of who we are, and I can't get away from being a coach. And I saw a few of my guys in there, so I'm going to coach a little here, Norris, take your hats off, please. Thank you. But, you know, they're great guys. But I, you know, going through life, it's kind of interesting. And we didn't have, well, I'm sure there was something like this, but kind of like Kathy, we had a gentleman on, I don't know if any of you guys ever heard of Don McSween, but Donnie was a 3-year captain here at Michigan State, and a tremendous, you'd be hard-pressed to meet a better human being. He's just an outstanding man. Lives in Grand Rapids, and it's funny how your lives overlap, but Donnie, his faith was really strong, and that was something that was a little different. Again, there wasn't, you know, this type of thing and this available, and although I think a lot of us, my wife and I started going out when I was a junior in high school, 17, and she was real good and raised in the Catholic Church, and we went a lot. She kind of brought me along, but when I saw Donnie and kind of how he defined himself, and he was really a 2-time All-American, All-Academic American. I mean, he had a lot going on, but the important part of his life was that. And after a few years of playing, I ended up back in Grand Rapids, Michigan, and that's where Donnie lives. And we ended up going to the same church, and he's just a really grounded person, and was just always a really good example. Now, I think he lived that a lot better than I did. And while it was always around, and we raised our kids in a Catholic church, and I went to church quite a bit, and then as we moved around, we were really lucky. We kept finding good churches and good priests and people that really connected with us and did a great job with our kids. But I think somewhere when we were in Ann Arbor, that's probably, I couldn't find a good church, we were in Ann Arbor. but my daughter who was here, Madeline, she did a great job, and she's in visiting, so I dragged her along. But we had kind of been a couple years without it, and they had, my youngest daughter, Madeline, they were kind of looking around for a church, and they found one, and we tried that, and it didn't really click with us, and then they found another one, and it's probably been one of the bigger things in my life in terms of, I think it's made me a lot better father, a lot better husband, a lot better coach, and hopefully a lot better person to be around, but just that message. And then, you know, those people come into your life, and you hear the same things over and over, and you guys have heard some great stuff up here, and they're all different questions, but it kind of all boils down to the same thing in terms of what you believe and how you're going to live your life and what's important in your life. And for a long time, I mean, I just defined myself that way. Well, I'm a coach. Well, I did this as a player, and you're introduced, and I was glad you didn't introduce me this way. You did this, this, and this. But that's not really what you are. It's what, you know, that's what you do for a living. And I've had this talk with a lot of guys. I don't know if, you know, there's 4 or 5 of our guys here. If I haven't, I probably will. And guys, you guys struggle, and like, you know, you were saying, you can't get a hit, or your Kathy's hitting it into the net, and when you're playing and things are going bad. But I've had that talk with a lot of young men and saying, hey, it's just a game. You know, get over it. And, you know, what you do in life, how you're interacting with other people on your team, you know, the differences you can make. I talked about Donnie, Kathy talked about the young lady that came over to her. Talk about a life-changing thing. So if you score a touchdown, or you have a great serve, or you hit 400, it doesn't really make, you know, that big of a difference. But then in talking to Phil, and he's drawn it a couple times. I don't either, maybe forget, he's getting a little old, maybe he forgets, but he's drawn it a few times for us, and really trying to hammer it home with us. But when he, you know, he draws the, the big divide and the cross at the beginning, and I'm sure you guys have seen it, it's really small, and you kind of justify things that you do, and then it gets a little better, or a little bigger, and a little bigger, and pretty soon that divide is really wide, and you've justified things. Well, I'm not as bad as that person over there, or I'm not as bad as that person, and it's okay, because I go to church on Sundays, so I can get away with that, and pretty soon, you know, that divide is pretty big, and it took me a long time, and I don't think I was a bad person, but I certainly wasn't doing the things that I should have been doing and influencing people how I should have. And when Phil drew that, I mean, that really hit home in terms of, you know, how I'm going to go about my life. Am I a coach, all right? Or, like these people, am I living life the right way, all right? Am I living my life for the Lord? And what Phil said the one day, you know, who are you serving? And that, makes a big difference. And don't think that you guys don't make a difference. And it doesn't, man, like I said, get over yourself sometimes. Hey, sports, it's just a game. I hate to say that. There's somebody, everything I've you know, paid for and done in my life, that's what it's come from. But I think it's helped me tremendously. This was probably, maybe record-wise, not one of the better years of Michigan State hockey, but it's probably one of my favorite years I've had coaching or playing because of the guys we have on our team. And I think a lot of that has to do with Joe and how we approach that season. So anyhow, that's just kind of how you go approach it. But you're not what your sport is. You're who you're serving. So.
Yeah, that's awesome advice. You know, visiting you in the hockey offices, you know, the door that I barged in on, boom! I go by all the pictures of, you know, the hockey greats, and there's Dan Cole, New Jersey Devils, hoisting up the Stanley Cup, right? Doesn't get any better than that, right? Well, what happens the year after, right? And so that's what I hear you guys saying. It's like, it's exhausting to think that something or some standard I put for myself will somehow fill the void in my soul. And we talk a lot about that here. Those things won't. They're cool, they're nice, but they really make lousy gods, right? And it's great to know that Jesus actually can free us from these little functional saviors that we have in our life. If people think I'm the best, newest coach on campus, life will be great. Well, for a day, right? And then life happens, so. Boy, wow, so much good stuff. Running out of time. Probably won't be able to get to every question here. I do want to ask this question, though. What was the most embarrassing moment as an athlete or a coach? I handpicked Jake and Carolyn on this one. So, you guys, mind being... Oh, what?
Yeah, right.
What? Oh, she has an answer? You didn't get a question yet, Carolyn?
Oh, that's okay. They got
no, 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 no. We're going to start off with this
I'm
one.
I'm soaking it all.
Come on, let's do embarrassment, and then you can share some words of wisdom. That can be embarrassing.
All right. Well, I called one. I had a few things that came to mind, but I called one of my teammates, and she was like, oh, gosh, I don't even know where to start. And then I thought, well, let's just slow down a little bit here. But their favorite that they said was, okay, so when I was on the team, I like to maybe my teammates in line a little bit and kind of be responsible and on time and kind of do all those things. And I usually wasn't the one to forget things and lose things, or I just didn't allude to that. Actually, I just hit it really well. But one time we were on a trip and we were coming back from the trip, and usually it's kind of a rush to get to the airport and make the plane from when we're done playing. And so we all get there, we're getting ready to go through security. I cannot find my license anywhere. Like, I look through everything. I have my backpack. I take everything out. I mean, it's stuffed with everything. I'm looking through everything. I'm like, can we, like, give him anything else? You know, I get out all my credit cards, anything I can find, my homework that says my name on it. And they're like, we're sorry. Like, you need your ID. And, you know, if anybody can know my head coach, Stacy, who I played for, she's like, seriously, we brought her here. Like, let's just take her home. We don't really want to stay in North Carolina. So she does some sweet talking and finally gets me on the plane, but everyone's pretty mad at me. And I just kind of want to crawl in a hole and die a little bit. So we finally get on the plane, and I'm like, okay, phew, everybody's in their seats. I'm just going to get out my book, and I'm just going to mind my own business. And Coach is obviously sitting right next to me. I open my book, and there's my license. I was using it as a bookmark so I wouldn't lose it, and I would have it available for the security line. So I still don't get to live that down now. Luckily, I haven't had as many embarrassing moments as a coach, but it's probably just because I haven't done it as long.
So. Oh, before you pass that to Jake, why don't you share, similar to what I let Kristen share, what do you know now that you wish you would know then, that some of the growth that's happened in your life?
Oh, gosh. I think one of the biggest things to know when I see, like, as coaching, and I kind of felt this as a player, but I didn't really know it as much there, was it's really easy to kind of be content. And so, you know, maybe you're playing well enough, or you're getting good enough grades, or you're doing things, you know, you have good enough relationships and that kind of thing, but you don't really know how much better it can be. And even with your relationship with God, you know, it's go to church, but there's still kind of that comfort level that you want to stay in, because, you know, once you get a little outside the comfort level, even if it's really good uncomfort, it's still uncomfortable, and it's easy to kind of shy back into, oh, that's a little uncharted territory. So, you know, if I'm for golf, whatever, I'm 7 under going the last hole, instead of making another birdie, maybe I'm like, let's just make a par and get it in the clubhouse so I don't make a mistake. But just not being okay with being content with where you're at, but really kind of pushing yourself in all the different areas of life to see how much better it can get and how much stronger in your faith you can get, because it's easy to put God in a box and kind of keep him in a comfortable place where it's good enough, but he wants more of us, and it does get better when you give more of yourself to the Lord and open your life to that. It can be a lot better, just as, you know, in your sport or relationships, the more you put into it, the better it can come back, you know, twofold to you. So I would say just keep pushing the boundaries with your relationships, and especially with your relationship with God, to see how much better it can get.
That's awesome.
So I was a bad Division III player, so I felt like every time I put the uniform on, it was an embarrassing moment for me. So I couldn't really pick one out from my playing days, and you may ask my players about an embarrassing coaching moment. But for me, one sticks out, and it was about 6 or 7 years ago, and we were down in Florida in Port Charlotte playing at a minor league facility, kind of on their practice fields. We were playing Pitt. And, you know, you play in a lot of stadiums and in nice places where they have a tunnel to the locker room behind the dugout and things like that. Well, this wasn't that at all. It was a, you know, field was nice, but we're sitting in dugouts that were chain link dugouts, and, you know, it was kind of a clover leaf, so four fields with a kind of an open area in the middle. And the game progresses, and there's a bad call against us. I go out to argue it, and the reasoning that I get from the umpires was just completely wrong. And I proved it to him in the rule book, and he didn't like that a whole lot. And so we kind of went back and forth and back and forth. And his, long story short, his justification to me was, you know, that we're going to advance their runner to third base because he had the opportunity to advance, which still doesn't make any sense. But I tucked that back in my head, and I'm beyond mad at this point. And I've been kicked out of a few games, and most of them have not been justified, in my opinion, but a couple have. So I'm getting on this umpire still pretty good, and our third baseman is standing there. Now the runner's at third base, and I yell out to our third baseman, his name is Torsten. I say, hey, Torsten, be careful, because if this base runner may have an opportunity to advance to home, and, you know, so we got to be really careful here. We don't want him to score, because he has an opportunity, and I hit that like 4 or 5 times. Stepped back from behind home plate, took his mask off, and he said, that's it, you're up. So he kicked out of the game. And I wasn't going to accept that. I said, why are you kicking me out of the game? Meanwhile, you know, I'm sitting in a chain link dugout and sitting on a bucket. And I said, you got no reason to kick me out. I didn't swear at you. I didn't call you a name. I didn't show you up in front of thousands of people. I'm just talking to my third baseman. That's all I'm doing. You can't kick me out for talking to my third baseman. And so he says, that's it. It's already done. I'm kicking you out of the game. You're out. And so I sat back in the bucket, and I leaned my feet up against the fence like this, and I crossed my arms like I was 4 years old, and I said, nope, I'm not going anywhere. Like, I'm taking my ball and going home. And my dad was my assistant at the time, and a lot of you know my dad. And he's sitting right here to my left, and I'll never forget it. I said, nope, I'm not going anywhere. And I hear my dad go, ugh. Like, he's just completely annoyed with me, like I was, you know, 4 years old again at the time. I'm like, all right, I think I better go. So when you get kicked out of a game, you have to be out of sight and sound of the game. That's the rule. So you play in these nice stadiums, you can go back in the tunnel and just kind of hang out in the tunnel. And you can still kind of coach the game from the tunnel. That's what happens. Like in the big leagues, when managers get kicked out, they don't go anywhere. They go sit out away from everything, and they're still running the game. So you can usually do that. Well, we're in this minor league facility that's this clover leaf, and it's all chain link fences, and there's open areas behind the dugout. The bus is about a half a mile away in the parking lot. I got nowhere to go. So I walk behind the dugout, and everything's all windscreen, and the umpires can't see me, and the umpires in the field can't see me, so I figured I'd just, you know, coach the game from behind the dugout. So I'm literally peering through, pulling back the windscreen, looking through this chain link fence, still coaching the team, and I got parents walking by me, like tapping me on the back, saying, hey, good job, man. And, you know, the other umpires are coming, like the umpire supervisor comes by, and, you know, this and that. And then I, all of a sudden it dawned on me that I just, A, just got kicked out of the game, and B, I'm standing with everybody back here, and I'm the only guy in uniform. So that was probably one of my most embarrassing moments.
Yeah, I can hear you, Dad. Well, we're out of time, but I just wanted to thank these guys again for taking their valuable time. Like, really valuable time. Thank you so much. This was such a treat because each person here could have taken the whole time themselves with stuff that they had to share, what they're currently learning. And so thank you so much for, again, taking the time and being willing to share stories of how you've grown and you know, and you're still, you know, you're not finished. You're still on the track and you're still growing. So.